Broadcast Network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Johnson. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hello, everyone. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. I am your host, Tony Moore, and today I am joined by one of the most beloved characters on Days of Our Lives. We have Mr. Matthew Ashford, better known as Jack Deveraux, here with us.
Yes, thank you.
How are you, sir?
Very good, Tony. Very good.
If you guys are joining in on the conversation live, make sure you hit the subscribe button. Also, check us out on iTunes and SoundCloud. Now, as you guys know, Days has been celebrating its 50th year, and we here at AfterBuzz want to bring you past members to kind of catch up with them and find out what they've been up to. So Matthew has so graciously came in, what I consider very early in the morning, to come in and chit-chat with us, but I'm sure it's not early for you.
It's not early for me. I have a baby boy, and he's up with before the sun. So, yeah, he's up very early. So,
how old is he?
23 months.
Oh, you know what I always find weird is when parents still do ages by months.
Well, it isn't weird until when they turn two, then you can kind of say two. but he's kind of big. Uh-huh. His mom is 5'9", mm-hmm. and his grandpa on Lana's side is 6'4", and there's people who I think in the family go to 6'7", and
oh,
there's
wow.
professional football players, so he might end up being a really big guy.
Nice. Well, congratulations.
Well, thank you.
On that.
His name is Henry, and he's a lovely, lovely little boy, and keeping it very real for me.
Well, yeah. Shout out to Henry for getting you up bright and early.
That's right.
This morning.
Yes.
So let's talk about Days and your time on Days. You were part of one of the favorite couples on Days, the infamous Jack and Jennifer. What did you like best about playing Jack?
I have enjoyed playing Jack very much because I think it came at a time in my life where I was beginning to accept myself, Matthew, as an actor. Mm-hmm. And Ken Gorday, the producers, writers, everybody was open to that. They were open to me bringing myself.
Yeah.
I replaced two other actors who, for one reason or other, they came and went within the year. And I had also been let go from One Life to Live, and then Search for Tomorrow came off after 3 years, was canceled.
Yeah.
And it was like, it was time to say, well, time to deliver. I mean, if I'm going to do this thing, what am I going to be? Is in myself. And mm-hmm. they were all very open to me. You know, I think the character had leukemia when I came on. Mm-hmm. And it was like, well, how do I play this? Okay. And I started exploring it. And then the producer, Shelley, I think it was at the time, said, she said, okay, just let it ride.
Yeah.
Get it going. I'm like, yeah. Oh, okay. We're going to move on from that. And I went, okay. So I began to find bring myself to something. And they were very open to it. And also, I worked with a lot with Mary Beth and Stephen Nichols, and they're just wonderful actors. And they were kind of like an acting class unto itself. They
yeah.
just, you know, I met Mary Beth, and they said, well, this is your wife. And she was 9 months pregnant, Mary Beth was. and she was just delightful. But she said, you know, she goes to kiss me and just those beautiful lips, and then she goes, but just like kind of kisses me, kind of misses my face, and like, oh. And he said, oh, but she's really in love with that guy over there with the eye patch. And he's your brother, but you don't know it.
What?
What? Anyway, I really felt like, wait a minute, we're married, but there's no connection between us.
Yeah.
But there's tremendous connection between these two. And also, I began to understand this world of the fans following that. Mm. And I had to make a choice of like, how do I recognize this? Am I just stone cold, deaf and dead to this energy? Mm-hmm. And I chose to recognize it in my own way.
Yeah.
So I began my journey with this character, the character of Jack, who ends up raping Kayla
yeah.
because of this rage. You know, it's a horrible rage. He could have killed her if he had a gun, but he didn't have a gun.
Right.
It was just an act of rage and anger and control. I got a chance to learn a lot doing that. And the producers were really, really supportive through that whole time. Producers and writers and creating things and allowing me to kind of show what this character was going through.
Yeah.
And so I have to look back and realize that that set me on this path and staying with the character.
Yeah.
So that's one of the, overall, what I really appreciate the most about.
Was it difficult coming in after two other actors, obviously, played Jack for a little bit? Because fans are very devoted to soaps. And when you come in kind of taking over a role, is that nerve-wracking because you feel like fans might have been attached to those people? Mm-hmm. Or like how was it for you stepping in as the third Jack,
Again, I didn't really know. I was pretty young myself. Mm-hmm. And I, from the work that I already done, that I had to make a decision. I had to choose. I had to do my own thing.
Yeah.
And I was even offered someone said, well, would you like to watch them? And, I thought for a moment, I said, well, no, thank you. I think the choices they made are their choices.
Right.
I'm going to make my choices, and I don't want to, you know, and if they don't work, the producers will tell me.
Yeah.
They were very supportive, and they said, go. And the biggest challenge was I didn't know what it meant to be kind of coming up against a super couple. I didn't know what that was.
Yeah.
And that was Mary Beth and Stephen. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't realize the storm I was kind of flying into just by being there.
Yeah.
And so I think if there was a challenge, it was coming into this story where this character of Jack was seen as a real interloper between these two beloved characters of Hatch and Kayla.
Yeah. And it's interesting, you just mentioned the rape that happened with Kayla, and that was actually brought up very recently on the show where Kayla explained to the new character Paige, because there's a whole slew of new people since Jack's passing that has come in, and that got brought up. But you're also very mentioned, still a lot, in the show, so you've definitely made your mark.
So it seems. Yeah, Mary Beth actually sent me. Sent me a Twitter message the morning of. She said, "Just thinking of you." We're sitting here talking about this, and ho hum.
Yeah. Are you still relatively close to any of the cast members? I know you work with Mary Beth now.
Well, I'm working with Mary Beth, Judy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the people on the bay.
Yes.
Yes, and when people come in, it's just really fun because we get to see each other in a new context. I don't see Stephen nearly enough. Wally, Billy Warlock is out there skiing, as far as I know, if I tell you right. I when I get a chance to catch up with people, it's great. Not nearly enough, as you begin to realize. And now I'm starting to be friends with crew members who were behind cameras and stuff like that for years, and we're always just trading a conversation or a joke, but off to work, and realizing now some of them have retired because they've worked there for 25 or 35 years, and now they're living their lives, and they're coming online, and whether it's Twitter or Facebook, and they're sharing their life, and you realize, oh, wait a minute, he's my friend, she's my friend, we've known each other for 20 plus years, you know, it's really amazing.
Days is such a close-knit family. I've worked on the show a few times doing background work, and I can tell that they're very close. What are your fondest memories of working on set with everyone?
Well, I have to say, I mean, I'll pick out just instances because they kind of they're emblematic of what has been possible. Mm-hmm. And there has been times when the show is moving, you know, they're shooting and shooting and shooting, and the producers actually we had a general shot, three cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I remember times when cameramen were calling in the shot because they were like, you know, they were putting it together and it was happening in front of you. It was really exciting to see.
Yeah.
And being a part of that and realize, okay, well, I'm just in front of the camera. I'm doing this, but these guys are sizing it up and this is the best shot. This is going to tell the story the best. And they're doing it as fast as they can.
Yeah.
And it's a very fast moving process. And that's amazing. But the people behind the camera, the people doing your makeup, the people doing and hair and the wardrobe and the people who are designing the set and the props, they have a lot of really interesting input. And sometimes I have been able to talk with them or kind of laugh about something that Jack has been doing or this and that. And their insight of what they think would be kind of humorous or funny is so enlightening. And, you know, it's I've been able to many times take their input, their insight, and kind of like interpolate it into it. Yeah, that's exactly what's going on. Because these guys, they know these shows.
Oh, yeah.
Very, very well.
Very well. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've encountered fans who remember more details than I think some of the actors do. Mm-hmm. What was your favorite Jack storyline? Because you had done many stints on Days. You were there from like 87 to 93, and then you came back, and then you left and came back. And out of all those times that you were on Days, did you have a favorite storyline that happened, or a few storylines?
Well, there have been a lot of great storylines, and that's I've got a chance to do a lot of really fun stuff. Mm-hmm. In terms of maybe my favorite, because of I kept learning through it. When I first started working with Melissa, mm-hmm. You know, as far as I know, she said, "Oh yeah, she's coming out of the children's storyline." Mm-hmm. Sounds very strange to say that now. But she was playing the teenagers and stuff like that, and she's a virgin.
We can
say that on this show.
We can say that word,
virgin. My character was the rapist.
Yeah.
So what were they thinking, putting us together?
Yeah.
And she was really delightful to work with, and ready to kind of just get to work and do things. But she mm-hmm. had come out of these kind of teen storylines in a way, and I was coming out of a very dark place, mm-hmm. and they couldn't just put these characters together. They had us work together.
Yeah.
But because it was my character was kind of toxic on a romantic level, mm-hmm. they just had us work. And so for the next over a year, year and a half longer, we worked, and we talked about, you know, writing and producing and, you know, creating a story, and my character was kind of trying to find his life again out of anything away from this darkness. Mm-hmm. And it made me think of the part of Citizen Kane where young Charles Foster Kane starts at the newspaper, and he is and is full of life and hope, and we're going to change the world. Although my character was decidedly very conservative, had gotten very hard-nosed, what he thought was hard-nosed. Mm-hmm. And then Melissa was playing bleeding heart liberal. So we were able to kind of play that a lot against each other.
Yeah.
And let, you know, if people were watching it, let them decide what mm-hmm. the story is. Or let them decide what the relationship is. And it worked really, really, really well.
Yeah.
It's something I wish they could do time and time again, allow these actors to find the characters, to find the passion and really work and not force a moment, because I think the moments are there.
Yeah.
And what I found is the fans, the people who watch the show, they're so much sharper than we are.
Yeah.
they see everything. They look way down around the corner. So it's our mm-hmm. job to keep it lively, keep it moving. And maybe it is going to be that, but maybe it's going to be something else. That storyline with Missy, where we got a chance to develop these two people working side by side in an office, which began, you know, an office romance, but became more, it kind of emblemized for me at one point, one of the magazine voted us within one magazine, worst kissers, worst, because I was, you know, I was like so uptight. Jack always kept his clothes on and the lights off if possible.
Best way to do things sometimes.
Oh yes, that's right. You know, keeps the mystery.
Yeah.
Then within the same magazine, they put us best love story, best romance, best couple, best love story.
Yeah.
This was within the same magazine, and I thought, that's interesting. I like that. But because they're so far from perfect. They've got so many challenges, and mm-hmm. it's not that he doesn't want to kiss her. He is so frightened and closed down that he can't. But finding the intensity with people who are trying to find each other, is, for me, I realized as an actor and an artist, to continually choose love, continuing to choose the desire to connect as over the desire to get away, becomes a much more vibrant choice. So I was able to play that with the support of, obviously, with Missy mm-hmm. and producers, writers, and everybody else for quite a few years. And that will always be for me kind of like a great, for me, coming of age as an actor storyline.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously, the work went over very well because fans absolutely love Jack and Jennifer together. You guys were like this one of the super couples on the show. What as the popularity came with Jack and Jennifer, like how did you feel at that time as far as like the fans receiving the super couple now? Because I know all this is like new for you, being young and like coming into this and the soap world and everything.
Well, we did this at one point. Jack was trying to save Jennifer, Vern, good old Vern, Wayne Heffley, rest in peace. Mm-hmm. She was marrying this character, Emilio, Billy Huffsey. And Jack, of course, didn't really want to have his fingerprints on, although he couldn't keep his fingerprints off the whole event. He chose to kidnap her from the wedding by smoking him up, pumping smoke into the room and then coming in and saving her, getting her on a fire truck and taking her down the road while she started beating all over him with his mask on. And they're playing Rescue Me. Meanwhile, we're doing the scene and I'm at the top of my lungs yelling. And this is what shows what I know. We're doing a long shot. Mm. And we did that shot several times over and over, getting this shot, got it down great. We're like, ugh. So now the producer, Al Rabin, also rest in peace, puts us into his car. And he's taking us to the next thing. He sits there and starts talking to us about becoming a couple. Mm-hmm. He says, I don't know how it happens, but it happens. Mm-hmm. I just, you know, I'm going, Suddenly I'm realizing, and he's expecting me to kind of chime in and say something. I don't say a word because I realize I've lost my voice. Mm-hmm. I was yelling so much, not supporting, just being, I mean, it's so stupid because you could never hear my voice.
Yeah.
And now we're coming in to do all the close-up scenes. So we have to, and we do all of them, running around. Talking about like this. What the heck? I've never heard it, but I'm sure my voice is just about like that. You know, because I had no voice.
Yeah.
And that was, to me, that was arriving at this place from being told, you guys are about to turn into something. Mm-hmm. And I showed up without a voice.
a good time to not have a voice.
Well, yeah, I mean, and so this is how these things, and usually this kind of stuff would happen and it makes me laugh and I end up laughing at myself. And Missy and I always laughed at ourselves because we just thought we were just the silliest goons.
Yeah.
And they kind of kept keeping it real for us. I said there was nothing super for us except just being silly. Mm-hmm. So that's, I mean, and I really appreciate, I mean, the focus and people writing for us and giving us a chance to bring our voices out. That's what was super for me. And the response of the fans, I had people telling me they watched it with their little kids and they watched, you know, intergenerational, you know, older parents with their sons who just, they wanted to just beat them up because I reminded them of their lawyer son, you know, and stuff like that. So it was, you know, becoming that kind of character and that kind of, you know, popularity was, for me, was really exciting because it gave me a chance to see the effect with so many different people. So it was very, very gratifying.
And of course, you we've mentioned Missy a lot, and you worked with her, you know, quite often. And we saw the great chemistry that you guys have had on camera. Off camera, what were some of the things and antics that you guys had or memories that you guys had to establish that chemistry on camera?
Well, it's really strange. We had both of our kids within a week of each other.
Oh.
Both of them. I don't know what was going on.
It's almost like two women like having their
Well, it was just, it was, yeah. And it's just interesting how that happened.
Yeah.
But our kids were born, within a week of each other, both of them, both sets. And Missy's just a very real person and would like to talk about very real things and being very honest about things. And like to laugh at us. And, you know, we could just kind of go and we'd see something and was just ridiculous, and you know, it's usually it was ridiculous that we were there in it. Mm-hmm. You know, she was just somebody it was enjoyable to hang out with and just talk about life things, which I think helped us bring in some normalcy to what we were doing, which sometimes it wasn't. I mean, I have to say, in one time we were rehearsing something, and Missy just was going through it, and she just. She wasn't really sure about it, and because it was like really, I don't want to say cheesy, it was very sentimental. But she was her comment about me, and as she was saying it, I said, you know what, that when you say it that way, you say those exact words, they are so grating on my nerves, because that's, you know, that how that gets to me, because it's just my, me and my character's sentimentality was just like, ugh, nails in the blackboard.
Yeah.
I said, just know that when you say that. Yeah. And because she wanted to get me.
Yeah.
And so she went ahead and just went ahead and said it very clearly, very sentimental. And I just squirmed. And she committed to it in that way. And it was, I could, she really, as an actress, she was really going like, is this even going to work? And she was kind of trying it again and again. And she went upstairs and we did it in front of everybody. They literally applauded afterwards. They went, wow.
Wow.
Because it was funny. It was really funny. It was like she took what they'd written and she used it and it worked like gangbusters. And it was funny. And I don't think Missy realized how funny she is and can be. But she was just there committing. She's a wonderful actress in that she's present and she listens. Mm-hmm. And that's something I always have to work on for myself. But, you know, thankfully for me, she was there for me.
Yeah. Now, we mentioned that you had done many stints on days throughout throughout the years, throughout your start. Was there ever a time where you felt like comfortable with the role, or like this, you enjoyed it more than others, or enjoyed like the storyline or where the character was going at certain points of your time?
Definitely. There's times when you feel like you're comfortable with where it's going.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the times you look back and go, oh, the writers are really writing for me, writing to me. And sometimes it's stuff is hard.
Yeah.
And you had to kind of work against something. You went like, hey, haven't we done this? Or, you know, I'm not there. And you know, I was learning from certain people, certain, you know, two actors or two, embrace that as well, because maybe I need to get out of my comfort zone. And I've had to get out of my comfort zone numbers of times. There was a storyline that where Tom Langan wrote in about, you know, Jack claiming to be gay. Mm-hmm. And he pulled me into his office and he said, we're going to do this storyline. What do you think? Because what he was really saying is, are you going to commit to it?
Yeah.
And I took a beat and I said, yeah, of course I'm going to commit to it. He said, well, it'll run just about a year. And it exactly ran 1 year.
Yeah.
And I realized he was counting on me to commit.
Yeah.
And I did. And it was very funny. And some people, I don't think they liked it, or they thought it was demeaning. And it was probably, we probably did do some things that were kind of stupid or off, not, I don't know, respectful or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But it was really interesting because it did all those things, and I really appreciated it was clearly what it was.
Yeah.
And it was light. It was a, you know, leitmotif. Jack was caught in making up a big lie, and he was caught with it, and then he just played it out to this ridiculous end.
Mm-hmm.
It was hard. You know, at a certain point it gets hard because the character got his nose rubbed in it so much that after a while that got hard. But that storyline, you know, challenged me to kind of bring that out as much as possible. Sometimes even harder just to do, you know, what my idea of heroism is common people rising to a moment as opposed to heroic people doing what they do every day.
Yeah.
So when it was called upon me to do something of a more quote unquote heroic nature, I would, I tried to find my way of doing it. That sometimes looked the exact opposite of what they were looking for.
Yeah.
But I think the fans, the people who are watching, appreciate it because they said, well, that's how Jack would do it.
Yeah. And speaking of fans, want to thank you guys again for joining in live in our chat. I'm going to get to some of your questions very soon, so make sure you are in the chat room with your questions, and we're going to take a look at those in just a few minutes. Being, you know, Jack, for as long as you have been, at some point do you get to talk to the writers about or give input as far as where you think a storyline should go? Because I think fans often wonder if you get a script and go, I don't think he would do this, you know, or you know, maybe we should play it this way. Do you ever have or had input as far as that?
Well, the truth is, I mean, we've gone through many years of things. There were times when it was really there was no real connection between the writers and the actors. They really kind of stayed apart, and it was not encouraged at all to even see an actor. And I think I've had some writers running away from me. and you know, because it was just too much chance for an actor to kind of say what they think. And sometimes we don't really see ourselves very well. Mm-hmm. And it got to hand it to the writers, producers to say, we see more in you. We want to see more out mm-hmm. of you. That's the way it used to be. There have been times when sometimes you bump elbows with somebody and they ask you something and you do have a chance to maybe relay something. And but for days, for the most part, I realized that as an actor, given the script, given the time we need to do it in, it was my job and my opportunity to say exactly what I thought about this character mm-hmm. with these words. Mm-hmm. And the way that I said it could really, really do that.
Yeah.
And that's what they're counting on. They're saying, if you have a point of view, mm-hmm. bring it. Mm-hmm. And if it's something that we need to tweak a little bit, we'll tweak it. Mm-hmm. But bring it. If don't not bring it and then talk later about, well, it should have been this, should have been that.
Yeah.
I've realized we have tremendous opportunity. You know, you could say two words a million different ways and mean all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what being an actor is, you know. So that's where I think, because the writers watch. You know, there is a, this was, and you should really check these guys out. The music people who, when they win awards and mm-hmm. editing music, they have, in back there in the inner sanctum of inner sanctums, they have cues, sound cues for characters.
Oh yeah,
and
we're very familiar with those.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if you ever had somebody on who could share that, but you know, this guy one day showed me. He says, "Oh yeah, this is Jack's theme. What's that? Oh, that's sad Jack. Well, what about happy Jack?
Yeah.
I'm like, oh my gosh. Yeah, and he goes, yeah, we have that. Then we have Jack and Jennifer's theme, mm-hmm. and he said we got it for everybody. And he goes, wait a minute, everybody? Yeah, everybody and everything. They've got a musical cue. And in my, John Aniston told me one day when I first was kind of like going dark with Jack, you know, mm-hmm. he said, "Don't twirl the mustache." And he pulled me aside, and I said, "Well, what do you mean? You don't have to overplay it. They got music to do that."
Yeah.
And I did that. Yeah, I mean, he said you don't have to. In fact, I started playing the opposite.
Yeah.
Because the music was going to play no matter what. Anyway, because those themes, I didn't realize they existed. Well, mm-hmm. this person, they come in at 5 o'clock in the morning and they plug in, based on the show, what they perceive to be the shape of the show musically, sonically, right?
Mm-hmm.
And through all the scenes, they read those scenes and they go, oh, it's going to go up and down here and there. And this guy said, you know, I have to tell you, watching you and Missy, I thought the scene was going to go this way. I plugged in all my music and you guys did it entirely opposite.
Oh, wow.
I thought it was a sad scene. And you made it funny. I thought it was a funny scene, and you brought in some pathos. You made it a little sad. So I have to wait until after I see you guys, then I can cue it.
Cue it, yeah.
And I said, thank you. I said, that to me, that's a real compliment, and mm-hmm. I really appreciate it, because we play with that stuff, and we find all sorts of things in it. And hopefully the writers were feeling the same way, that we could bring, we're going to bring more than just a sad moment. We could, you know, happy, sad, anger, fear, everything.
Yeah. No, we're definitely familiar with the different songs and themes. My other co-host, Peter, he always comments on, currently Eve has come back into Salem, and she has this kind of like bayou, like Louisiana kind of theme. It's like a or something like that. Anytime she's feeling some sort of way, so he always comments on that during our recap.
It's, oh my gosh.
It's very strange, the things that you pick up on or the sounds that you hear, and you're like, yep, that's obviously that character. You can be in a different room and know which character.
Isn't that interesting?
They're discussing. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, well, and it's very powerful what we hear through our ears. And yeah, I mean, I find out that Eve is like, geez, it's not Charlotte Ross anymore.
No.
But didn't you guys know? Yeah, you guys had sex and you had a baby. What? You know, I mean, it's kind of shocking.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, at this time, my character, Jack, has more family on the show than have in years.
Yeah.
It's kind of crazy.
Yeah. And yeah. I mean, sadly, well, we had two scares at one point in time. Jack first was killed off of the show when they did New Salem, where they were killing off everyone and everyone appeared on the island. Can I just say, I remember watching Days during that time and so scared, thinking like, where are they putting these people? Where are these characters going? And it was the first time I think I actually the internet to find out, are these people, are have contracts ended? Are they being fired? Like, what's happening with these characters? Was that a scary time for you? Like, did you guys know what the writers were doing during that storyline?
For speaking for myself, no. And I think most of us didn't.
Yeah.
It was, they created a whole nother story. And no, we didn't know. I mean, I left the show. I left the show and went over to One Life to Live.
Yeah.
Managed to kill off a bunch of people there. Jeez. Oh, my gosh. So sorry. If it had been a few years later, we could have gone on to that island, wherever the hell we were, that alternate days of our lives or universe, and it could have been on the web.
Yeah.
I was going to say, well, we just went to new media.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's where we went. it was very strange. They were the same sets, but they had plants growing up through them. Mm-hmm. And I thought, this is kind of like, it's a very interesting alternate universe.
Yeah.
And I chose to... I said, well, where's Jack? How come Jack kind of stays kind of apart from this? Because I keep going out into the jungle because I don't trust these buildings. I think we're all being wired for sound, which we were.
Yeah.
We didn't know, as the actors, we didn't know this. And I thought, I don't even know if these people are really who they say they are. It's very much like, there was a TV show called Prisoner back in the 60s where Patrick McGoohan, I know that's real. Who the heck is Patrick McGoohan? stuck on an island. Prisoner. Yeah. Is that what I mean? Prisoner. Yes. I went to a really show all about, you don't know who you're with.
Yeah.
And we played that a little bit, but I think they open the door sometimes, these great opportunities. Mm-hmm. But if it had been today, they could have taken that whole alternate universe into a whole side web world.
Yeah. And that would have been very interesting to see.
Yeah. I mean, and who knows? I mean, nothing, they're still going and it's still going. So. Yeah. So
now, sadly, Jack left the show in a very interesting way, by way of elevator.
Yeah, it went down. took the freight.
How did you about that? Did you know beforehand that they were gonna kill off Jack, or did you one day come in and receive the script and go, "Oh, I die"?
Oh no, I knew. I mean, they let me know. They let me know quite a while ahead, I think, at that point. They, sometimes they're cautious about that, but it had happened to me enough. I think they knew that I was like, well, okay. it was, it's never easy. And you kind of see the writing. Not only the writing's going to be on the wall, but you see it being written.
Yeah.
And it's happening within the scenes and stuff like that. That can be kind of hard. And trying to... And the day of, in the elevator was, we were set inside an elevator that was flat on the ground, and the elevator was supposedly dropped. Why couldn't we just get out? We tried to play, and maybe the audience couldn't really see this, that we were actually below the wall. We had to play that we couldn't just climb out.
Yeah.
And that made it really, really, that was an extra physical difficulty. It wasn't built. The set wasn't built to do that for one reason or another.
Yeah.
So... we had to kind of play with this unreality at the end, which was a challenge. And then, after it dropped, and I think Josh came back and wrote, he's Roman now, I think.
Yes.
Roman. And he comes in and they said, oh, yeah, they take him out. Yeah, yeah. Well, Jack died a hero. And I went, died a hero.
Now, if you could have rewritten Jack's death, How would you have had Jack die? Because we all look at the elevator and go, I mean, Jack, I don't know if we want Jack to die in that way, but and most fans felt like, and still do feel like, maybe you're not dead, maybe you're somewhere else working on a story, maybe you're captive or whatever. Fans can really come up with a whole good storyline for you.
Yes.
But if you were able to kill off your character, how would you have rewritten his death?
Probably like Voldemort. Probably drawn and quartered into 9 pieces. and each piece had its own, the romantic part went that way and the really wicked part went that way. Yeah. I mean, because you can kind of do a lot. I mean, if you get conceptual about it, like the poor people who got sent off into, Star Trek got sent off onto they got pushed the wrong button and then they're shot. They're shot. Who knows? I mean, like obviously the classic Han Solo, Frozen.
Oh, yes.
Oh, that, come on. That, what a way to go. I got a friend who's got a solo in his apartment still after all these years, life size, huge Frozen. So he's still there. You know, something like that, that'd be just fun and romantic in the adventurous sense.
Yeah.
I just realized you can, in soap operas, you can pretty much do anything. And opera means heightened.
Yeah.
You know, we weren't just selling soap. It was a heightened reality. I guess I would probably find some really exciting, you know, the elevator was exciting enough.
Yeah.
But, believe me. But something like that, that would have been kind of fun too.
And what was your reaction to the show deciding to kill off Jack? Because I mean, you've been playing this character for quite some time, and then, you know, then you find out, okay, you know, they're going to kill off the kid. Like, what was your reaction to that?
Well, it's something that had to happen to move ahead with what I think they wanted to do. There are a lot of, I mean, within any television world or, you know, production world, there's changes at the top as well, and changing in producers, changing writers, head writers, and everything like that. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, and I have to take this as a compliment, my character cast a pretty big shadow.
Mm-hmm.
And for the incoming writer, to do what they were going to do, my character was very clearly in the way.
Yeah.
And so, you know, they had to say, well, he's got to go.
Yeah.
Along with other people too. But I mean, I'd like to think that it wasn't because I was just boring.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was because I was doing my job and being an integral part, which sometimes is very hard to do on these shows, especially if your character's kind of like signed it out. But I always tried to bring something in,
yeah,
to play with and play with the people in the scene.
Yeah.
So I think it was totally understandable when I found out that that's really what it was.
Mm-hmm.
It's just another change.
Yeah.
And it happens in every business. When the people up top come in, they usually say, well, it's so that we can change all the chairs down here.
Yeah.
So.
And now a lot of fans are hoping, wishing, praying that Jack comes back. And there is no person bigger on the hashtag Bring Jack Back bandwagon than my co-host, Mr. Mark J. Freeman. And unfortunately, he couldn't be in studio with us, but we actually do have Mark on the phone.
Mm.
Mark, are you there?
I am here.
Hello, Mark. Hey. How are you?
I am bouncing off the wall.
Look, we brought Jack back.
I'm in your seat. I'm in your seat, man.
So, I even wrote in my notes. I'm like, he's sitting in my chair.
Now, Mark,
since
we began our day's recaps, Mark has been on the bandwagon to bring you back.
Mm-hmm.
And so now that I have you back for
a little bit, at least.
I wanted Mark to have a chance and opportunity to ask any burning questions or just to chit chat with you.
Okay.
However you feel, Mark.
I'm very excited. Thank you for being there. Then you see, Matthew, they had to move me out of the studio because they didn't trust me in the room with you.
To an undisclosed location with the vice president. Yes. Yes.
I said, Tony, you did this on purpose. You were afraid of how I would react.
I didn't. I swear I didn't do it on purpose. It just so happened to work out that you were far, 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 far away from L.A. That I could bring Matthew in.
Yes.
It wasn't
well, I even thought, too, I think it's even more appropriate because I'm at my mom's house, which is where I grew up and where I used to watch Dave. So I think it's even more appropriate that I'm sitting here where I began watching Jack and
you
being able to ask
you tape a picture of me
so
to the screen.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. You're welcome. Well, hello to Ohio.
Yay! Hello to Ohio.
Yes.
All right. Hold on. I got a lot of notes here. I got to focus.
Okay.
First of all, Tony.
Yes.
I'm upset that you're referring to any other human being that would have played Jack. There's only one Jack, and it is Matthew Ashford.
Well, we had to
just take that off the table. We're not even going to talk about them.
We had to let them know
that their careers,
that there were two
Matthew
more people
Ashford
before, but Matthew is Jack. He is the only Jack.
Yes.
There is no other Jack.
So you said
Matthew
two
Ashford.
Other Jacks. I was like, I don't even know what he's talking about. People, they don't exist. So Matthew, it's just you. Just so you know.
Thank you. Thank you.
And is it Stephen that's there with you, Tony?
Yes, Stephen is here.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to put my picture back up, Stephen. I noticed, Jack, Matthew, you have my hair. My hair is a celebrity on the show. Yes. And your hair looks very similar to mine now. And I love that. I love that. I didn't love you more. I love you even more now.
Well, thank you.
Can we see you here, Stephen?
So other than the Bay, where can we find you?
On Twitter, Matthew_Ashford. That's how that works. And then there's a Matthew Ashford. I have a Facebook account. There's also, and I, you know, I've been setting up these MatthewAshford.com, MattAshford.com, MatthewAshford.net. Going to the same place, setting up a what would we call a web presence of that. And we're working on that. It's such a shock to me, not to people now, but you know, I went to school, North Carolina School of the Arts in Winston-Salem, and was trained for acting. And now you have to be promoting yourself, and you have to have these online presence and things like that kind of have nothing to do with the development of the character, the development of your craft. In that way, it's another craft. And so I'm running, struggling to catch up. But I'm appreciating that people are actually asking, you know, and I'm realizing that this is something I have to do and keep up. I mean, I would rather do it in conjunction with the character I'm working on than talk about what I did today or had to eat today or something.
Right.
I mean, and I know that's a gross simplification of what people do. I am struggling to kind of catch up with that. But I appreciate being able to be here today to do something that, talk about something that I feel like, well, this is something I know about.
Yeah.
We'll always say, well, I tweet enough about you as well.
Well, thank
on
you.
On behalf of Days of Our Lives. So,
well, thank you. I think I've seen
I'm
that.
I'm going to help you in that regard.
Well, thank you. So it's hashtag bring Jack back.
Yes.
Hashtag bring Jack back.
Wow.
Yeah. From day episode one of AfterBuzz, I started the hashtag bring Jack back.
Oh, yes. I really appreciate that. And I appreciate that your idea about Matthew Ashford, me being Jack. I mean, it was actually ended up being played. They four or five different actors took a whack at him. And
No, they're not there for a reason.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that as well. Well, you know, it's real. If I could say, I mean, very often I think they think characters get settled and, you know, get too normal. And Missy and I were always tried to be anything but normal, although we thought our characters thought they were normal. My wish was that we had been allowed to be happily divorced. Kind of come back and allow us to be, you know, to venture into this new world, because realizing within society, huge numbers of people have had a previous relationship, previous marriage, all sorts of, and they go on. And sometimes they actually are friends or have a relationship with that person that, you know, or even if they don't talk to each other, they have a relationship. And I think it's a great, great material for where we should be going. I think Melissa and I could have caused each other just so much mayhem as we both tried to move ahead with our personal lives without having to be, actually married to each other. I think, who knows in the future, but that's just one thing I kind of realized, is that when you're really connected, you're really connected. And it doesn't matter whether you're married to that person or not. And it can create such wonderful dramas and dynamics. And it also says that people are never really gone from your life, which I think is a really positive thing. For me, is just one thing I'd like to see more of, whether with Missy's characters or mine, or just in general, to recognize they have a connection and they don't necessarily have to be sharing a bed all the time and married to do it. They can be just deeply connected people.
Mark, do you want to share some of your how Jack can come back to the show theories? Because he's had many.
My options? Well, we never saw the body, first of all.
Okay.
So, he's not dead, by the way. I don't know if the writers told you that, but I've decided he's not dead.
Okay.
So, he's on an assignment. He had Roman was in on it, because if you remember, Roman is the one that told Jennifer and Abigail that he's dead.
So
Roman's in on it. He knows that you're on an assignment. He had to keep it a secret. and you had to go out and do a story. Because you know Jack, he's got to follow the story.
Follow with his name.
And also, Will's a writer now. Nicole is an investigative reporter. These are appropriate positions for the spectator. So these, you have a staff. You can come back and get the spectator back up and going. Jennifer can help. It'll be a little family affair. Done. Deal. Dina and Josh, you're welcome. There's your story. We're bringing Jack back.
There it is. There you have it. There you have it.
So but before we move on, Mark, any last words or comments or questions? For Matthew?
The last thing I have written down is I'm at Lorraine Love on Twitter if you want to follow me, Jack. Or Matthew, sorry.
At Lorraine Love?
Yes.
No, what is Lorraine?
Oh, I'll tag you in a million things today, so just, you know, follow.
Okay, just follow. follow.
So when that follow happens, Mark, you must screenshot that. And we'll discuss it this Sunday during our recap.
Okay, perfect. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Mark, for calling in all the way from
Ohio.
Thank you
for letting me call in.
No problem.
And I wish I could have been there, Matthew, to shake your hand. Although I did meet you once on set with Kirsten Storms in the makeup room long time ago.
Okay. Well, we'll do it again.
Fond memories that Mark has of you.
Yes.
Thanks,
you.
Mark. We'll see you when you get back.
All right, thank you. Have fun.
All right. Thank you.
Okay.
All right, so we're going to go to the chat room. We have a couple of fans with some questions. Our Melvin fan asks, hi, Matthew, do you have a favorite scene you've done with Kate Mancy? I love your on-screen chemistry. Of course, Kate Mancy played your daughter, Abigail.
Yes. And not the first Abigail, we have to say.
Yes. She,
there have been numerous the Abigail. gosh, with Kate... she had to let me know her deep disappointment, her character's deep disappointment with my character, and to hear it and to realize at the same time this is also Kate getting a chance to really develop herself. Mm-hmm. It was really hard stuff, and it was like something she had to let out.
Yeah.
And having daughters of my own who have to let me know how, you know, disappointed they are in me from time to time, or all the time. I just, you know, I realized this is good, and I was just working on listening, because usually Jack is one to talk. So I really enjoyed that, because she was finding that, and it wasn't just a big blow fest of just crying and yelling. Mm-hmm. She really had to, and Kate was doing that. She was, you know, it's really hard. She has to tell someone that she loves that they have not risen, that they have really let them down, and it was good. I couldn't tell you the episode number, but you know, it happened. I was there.
We have another question from Caroline Topol, who asks, would you be open to going back to Days?
Would I be open to going back to Days? I have been in the past. I will be in the future. I mean, it's a character. My agent used to ask me, you know, because he always would check in with me and tell me I hadn't changed, I looked the same, you know, whatever. pass the ketchup. He would ask, but really, I mean, the question was like, well, how's it going in Days, and is this something you want to continue with? And it has consistently been, the character's been great, and has remained very fluid for me. It's an enjoyable character, and I can plug into any series of situations. I feel like I'm ready to bring in some of the darker stuff, the notes of whatever he is or wants to be, and I can do it. Mm-hmm. So and the show, you know, they've been very open to things in the past, so yes. I mean it just depends. I would like, if I came in, I would like to come in with something to do, as most actors do. Yeah. I mean, I was always hoping to kind of find out that I was somehow a Demira, you know, at some point or other.
Can I just secretly tell you that's my angle too? If I ever could be on the show, I would like to be a Demira as well.
Well, you know, Joe Muscolo is father of our country.
He has more kids he on has that kids show
everywhere.
And they explain it so well. So we just kind of take it like, oh, yeah. Here we go. Another Demira.
Another Demira. I know it's pretty. He's a prolific character.
Yes.
Yes. Wow.
Caroline again has another question for you. Which was harder to play, the intense drama depressed Jack or the extreme humor and romance scenes?
Which was harder?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they both kind of call out an intensity and focus. You know, the thing with the comedy stuff is like we were moving at a pace that if you get it wrong, it ain't gonna work. Mm-hmm. It won't work. And I had to sell stuff really fast and hard. And get it right, make sure it was right. So as I recall at that time with a lot of things, with that kind of, if it was high antics and stuff like that, I had to really know what I was doing and be willing to sell it. Because if they didn't like it, they didn't get it, they go, then they may, you know, they go with another choice. So that was a real challenge. It's a real challenge to try to do something that's funny on a show. They say, we don't do funny, and I was told that.
Yeah.
The depressed work, much more recently, although I think Jack has struggled with depression probably most of his life. it just comes out in different ways.
Yeah.
And actually, that is true. I think I had a few, because our time is limited, opportunities to say, get out what I was going to get out and find the right way to do it. And if it's the cases like in the scenes with Deidre, it had to come out in just such a way. And she had to bring it out, and to have to be enough and not too much, you know. And maybe we did go a little too much. They both required an intensity. They were both difficult. The funny things went on and on. At a certain point, there's an expectation. Maybe the ones with that level of depression were written specifically to that. So the funny ones might have been a little harder because you're talking about a lot of different events. I didn't play some of those depressed scenes coming out. And I'd had a chance. They'd actually done this whipping thing for beatings. I was like, terrible. we had to play that. And actually, I was strung up like I had to hang by chains. Chains were, let's see, the chains weren't long enough,
mm-hmm.
or they were too long or something like that. It was like my feet weren't off the floor or something like that. I had to like bend my knees. And it was hurting my wrists. I was going, ow, 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 ow. I was like, oh, first world actor problems. You know, my chains hurt. Ouch. And so that was, actually, they was really hurting my wrists when I was doing this thing. It's like, this is, I'm so going to laugh while I'm doing this while I whip. And this guy's whipping me with this wet noodle that looks like a whip. And he's this Israeli actor who's like putting on this, all this stuff, making himself look like a dark Arab man. Uh-huh. And, you know, and I was just talking to him. I said, do you do this a lot? He says, well, actually, more than I like to admit. But I remember, you know, but I got a chance to experience that. So that was helping me. And I'd see it later on. Went, oh, that sound looks really terrible. Mm-hmm. And that kind of helped me do some of the depression type scenes. The comic stuff, it just has to come and into that moment.
Yeah. Mark has one more question for you.
Okay.
He wanted to know, who do you miss working with besides the immediate family, like, you know, Jennifer, Missy Reeves, Abigail, the Abigails? Who else outside of Jack's immediate family do you miss working with?
Well, there's so many. I've had a chance to work with a lot of really wonderful actors. Mm-hmm. I mean, one who just comes to mind immediately is Wayne Heffley, who's passed away. Mm-hmm. And Wayne, after 600 movies and being in the business for 60 plus years, he said this was his favorite work he'd ever done because he had a chance to really work and create characters, starting with Jeannie Francis and, you know, mm-hmm. kind of working on with Missy and me and the numbers of people. And he was always wanted to rehearse and work and bring out something and create this Sancho Panza to my Don Quixote type, you know, and he's what he was going for. He's a writer of his own.
Yeah.
And we just had a chance to do some really wonderful things together. So he comes to mind immediately, but, you know, Joe Campanella, Jimmy Luisi were my two dads, my two dead dads.
Mm-hmm.
Jane Elliott, I would just wish I could have, we could have worked together more as the years went by. I realized, well, how wonderful she is as an actress. And I know she's kind of directing and producing now as well.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a list. And, you know, and again, I said, like, Steven, I haven't really worked with Steven in years. Mm-hmm. And we had a chance briefly, and it was like, you know, we have something going. We could really, really do stuff. A lot of those people come to mind. Mm-hmm. And there's just wonderful people. Some of the women are just amazing. Just, you only have a blip of a moment with them and you realize, like, even Susan Seaforth Hayes just never stops. And
yeah.
She's just a wonderful actress. She is on, she is sharp, she's smart, beautiful, mm-hmm. witty, everything. And, you know, they broke the mold
yeah.
after her,
yeah.
you know, and, just getting a chance to work with, you know, these wonderful actors. I mean, Mac and Frances were really kind of interesting in their own ways. They had their own way of working, mm-hmm. and if you could get in there and do something with them, they were very, there was, you'd be surprised, but, you know, Frances could zing you.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Now, now that you have left Salem for many, many years, what is Matthew Ashford up to now? We mentioned the Bay. Mm-hmm. A little while ago.
Definitely working on the Bay,
playing
different variations of characters that have been, I feel like have been Jack at different times. Yeah, I'm having a great fun, and it's a very small group, so we're working very intently together, writers, mm-hmm. producers, actors, and that's really a lot of fun. And it's probably like what Days was like maybe in 1964, 65, I guess.
Yeah.
A lot of fun doing that. I'm, you know, writing, producing, with some partners. Tranquil Bay Entertainment is the name of our company. Mm-hmm. John Mullis, David Ross, Tommy Kelly, they're all back east. And
yeah.
Working on some faith-based projects and some wacky, you know, also something wacky. And a lot of stories, a lot of writing, a lot of characters, a lot of interesting scripts and pitching like everybody else. That's going on. I'm teaching a little bit, sticking my toe into that particular pool or pond, and with total respect for teachers, believe me, it's mm-hmm. it's not easy to do it and do it well. I auditioned yesterday for Oregon Shakespeare Festival, which mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I was trained to do Shakespeare.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of going dusting that off and kind of like, yeah, because I mean, and that's one of the greatest Shakespeare companies in the United States, and I believe in the, you know, probably, who knows, maybe in the world.
Yeah.
I'm doing that, and you know, just you know, remaining creatively alive and trying
yeah.
to find, as we all are, trying to find our footing in this 21st century post three network world.
Yeah. you're definitely exploring different mediums as far as when it comes to acting and also producing and directing.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that theater is your background. You also did Mamma Mia back
yes.
a few years ago.
Yeah, that was great fun. That was like, that's like a soap opera on an island in a musical on a stage. It's the perfect package. I mean, people were so happy when they see that show. Men yeah. and women too. I see plenty of guys out there tapping their feet and bouncing
yeah.
their heads, loving it.
Listen, you can't help but to tap your feet to some good old ABBA music.
I yes.
mean,
you
don't want to, but it happens.
But it just happens.
It just happens. It's like yeah. something about that just takes over you. So which are you finding? I know that you do a lot of creative things, but which are you finding most creative for you right now? The on camera stuff, the stage stuff, or the directing, the writing stuff?
Well, it's fun to do the. When you're actually producing something, getting something to the point, that takes over, and that is a lot of fun. And being a part of something, creating and shooting a movie, and being behind the scenes with it, as mm-hmm. well as then going on, that's really, really fun. But those shows, you make them, you create them, and then you work on selling them, and
mm-hmm.
but this ends up becoming the real challenge for most artists and people creating.
Yeah.
That's all consuming when that happens.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's other things to do, like, you know, trying to keep writing and working on stage is, again, all consuming when you're in that play and doing
yeah.
that. I mean, that's what I really enjoy doing that. Mm-hmm. But it does sometimes take you away from your home, takes you, you know, you're on tour, you're going away.
Yeah.
You got to be ready to do that as well. And like I say, and then having a child is all consuming. I love all of them. You know, working on, you know, obviously working on a television show is a, it's a, like, you get to work, you get, the movie isn't over in 2 weeks, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, you know, 20 weeks, whatever. Mm-hmm. It, you, if the show is successful, you get to come back to it again and again and again and keep exploring. Mm-hmm. That remains one of the most, you know, joyful things that I get a chance to do.
Yeah. And going back to your current project, The Bay, what have you enjoyed about that? You've gotten to reconnect with Mary Beth, mm-hmm. and work with her on that, because she's featured on it as well. What is it like being now on a social media platform, which is definitely taking over mm-hmm. this? And is it, how different is it to go from, you know, a show like Days to like The Bay, which is just really featured on a social media platform? Yeah.
Well, it's much more, it's really is we kind of live and rise and fall on the interest in the breaths of the audience, the people who are watching. Mm-hmm. And you say, well, I'm doing what I do, but if the audience doesn't really care for it, you probably won't be doing it very much.
Yeah.
And so I think you kind of have to really bring your authentic self as much as you can mm-hmm. to the work. And like, I mean, I'm getting a chance to work with, you know, Tristan and Ron Moss. You know, obviously like Mary Beth and just people from, you know, new people, friends, who are really, you know, great new actors, young actors. I mean, they're just, everyone's getting a chance to work very closely together, and yeah. you get to, there's not a whole bunch of layers of, you know, where you may or may not have gotten a chance to be with each other. These mm-hmm. these guys are not people I would have been necessarily hired with, because they'd say, oh, we can't afford all you guys.
Yeah, yeah.
So here we are. And I feel like this is like the early days of television. Mm-hmm. This is like 1947. You know, mm-hmm. the first sets have just twinkled on, and people are going, what is this? I don't know. I mean, I'd rather listen to it. I don't know. And the actors are coming from their other shows, their other live theater, whatever they're doing, their radio. Mm-hmm. And they're coming and working on this little camera thing, like, you know, it doesn't really pay much, or, you know, but I'll do it. We're back at that place again, and it's exciting, because 30 or 40 years from now, we'll say, hey, we were there. Mm-hmm. We were the ones there. You may not remember our names, but we were there. You know, I was the howdy doody of our time. So
yeah,
that's my hashtag.
Howdy doody of our time. Hashtag howdy doody of our time. Yes. Now, The Bay has actually been nominated for
yes.
an Emmy. So yes. congratulations on
Thank
that.
You.
And you're no stranger to being nominated mm-hmm. for an Emmy. You were nominated back in 2012 mm-hmm. for Outstanding Supporting Actor. What's it like? What's that feeling to have recognition for your work?
Well, that's really, well, it's very exciting, because I'm really getting that recognition after years of that work. And then, you know, I was nominated. And the fact was, at that point, the show won best writing mm-hmm. in that year. And mm-hmm. the storyline they chose was the storyline that I was a primary part of.
Yeah.
So Ken Corday said, this is the first time in 37 years we won. And, you know, the writers are coming down like, what? Us? What? You know? So to me, that was actually more exciting. To have helped bring that writing to, you know, to award level mm-hmm. After all those years, I finally went, well, that's cool, because I know that I'm a big part of that.
Yeah.
So it has been very exciting, and doing the same thing with The Bay is realizing we are new approaches, and we're going to rise to the level of the high notice of getting a nomination. That's pretty cool too.
Yeah, and as you guys all know, the Emmys are coming this Sunday.
Yes.
So from all of our fans and from me, mm-hmm. we hope that you guys pull the win this year for The Bay,
and you
come out with that daytime Emmy for
yes.
your work.
Thank you.
Before we close out, because we have to wrap up here soon, what else can we expect from you upcoming? We know that you have The Bay. Are there any other upcoming projects that you have pending or going on that we can look out for?
Nothing that's actually to the point of ready to be aired or shown
mm-hmm.
and you know, when stuff comes up, you know, you audition for stuff all the time, and then
yeah.
like then it happens. I mean, I'll let you guys know
yeah.
if there is something.
Are you going to tweet people?
and I'll tweet him. I'll tweet. Yeah, I'll tweet. Yes, I will tweet.
Tweet us and let us know so that we can continue to stay supportive. And until then, Mark will be on the crusade to bring you back today.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Matthew, for coming in
and
joining us today. And thank you guys for joining us. Make sure you check out our Days of Our Lives recap every Sunday right here on AfterBuzz TV at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Before we leave, one more time, Matthew, where can they find you if they want to keep up with you?
Matthew Ashford isn't one at facebook.com and Matthew_Ashford is on Twitter, so follow me and help me launch that puppy as we launch all the puppies into the wind. There's a strange metaphor.
Trust me, after this I'm pretty sure you're gonna have some some new followers, including Mark.
Well, thank you, Mark.
And of course, you guys can find me on all social media platforms on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, at Lounging with Tony, and of course, my website, loungingwithtony.com. Thank you guys so much for tuning in to AfterBuzz Spotlight On, and we will see you again next time.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.